I'm Susan Allan. I'm the director of the Northwest Center for Public Health Practice, which is at the School of Public Health in the University of Washington. I'm also an associate professor in the Department of Health Services. Public officials talking about infectious diseases to the public need to be really careful about it's a balancing act of wanting to protect people and inform them, but not frighten them. In a situation where you don't have an emergency, that's not so difficult because you give them the best science in the clearest way that you can and tell them what to do. In an emergency, the guideline is to balance as carefully as you can around the uncertainties. You want to be safe, but you also have to warn people there are a lot of things you don't know, and you might tell them something different the next day. And that's actually very challenging. The media are incredibly important in an emergency, in an infectious disease situation, in helping get practical, clear information to a lot of parts of the community that the public health officials, that the government otherwise may be challenged to reach. The difficulty for the media, one of them is that they often are not as familiar with the scientific terms, and the translation into normal English, normal people speak, doesn't always go smoothly. There is a tendency in some media to try to sensationalize things, so they highlight the scary parts and not always give us balance to situation. I think we actually did not see a lot of that kind of pandering, frankly, in the recent flu situation. I actually thought the media presented a really clear, comprehensive explanation of what was going on, at least in this part of the country. And in probably across the U.S., but that's not always the case. I think we've had some other situations, like with SARS, where there was a lot of irresponsible journalism that scared people and even resulted in some pretty frank bias and stigmatization of the Asian communities during that era. But the media can be challenged by changing information. So being clear that we know more literally day by day than we previously did, and therefore our recommendations are changing, that can be hard to convey in a positive and effective way. Coordinating information in a rapidly moving, rapidly changing disease outbreak situation is probably one of the most important and one of the hardest things to do well. The recent H1N1 flu situation was really pretty successful compared to a number of past events. So if we think back to, I think, SARS and also to the anthrax situation in 2001, I could provide a lot of examples where the coordination among agencies, local, state, national, international, or even one community to the adjacent community, did not go very well. There's been a lot of investment, both of money and of attention, since those events in learning what are the, in differentiating the roles. So what's the local role? What's the state role? What's the federal role? How do two states communicate? Portland area, for example, you've got to have both Washington and Oregon coordinating. And I think the training and the exercising, the spending time together, showed in the much better consistency and, frankly, speed of response that we had with the recent flu situation. But the other challenge, I was just talking mostly about the public health agencies coordinating. It's also important to recognize that the public health officials have to be part of a concerted community response. So they have to also be able to work with police, fire, schools, restaurants, businesses, with the leadership in their communities. That's still a work in progress. There's a lot of different people to talk to, but that also, I think, is something there's been a lot of progress on. the challenge of what do you call a disease? Do you call it H1N1, which is not very memorable, or swine flu, which is more memorable but somewhat misleading? That's a real difficulty, I think, for the officials. And then the officials can have an official title, but then the public maybe picks up a different title as well. So figuring out what you call a disease is not a small thing. SARS was really tough. Severe acute respiratory syndrome, gulp. SARS at least was pronounceable, although it's not meaningful. And maybe in some ways that was a good thing because it sounded like a new story rather than echoing an old story. Calling this swine flu was misleading and problematic in a number of ways. It was good for editorial cartoons, but I'm not sure it was good for health or science. And it also has led to a lot of people who don't either have a background for understanding the science or don't listen to the whole story to quit eating pork, or there were countries that killed all of the pigs in the whole country. That's not only goofy, but it's harmful. I mean, it's people's livelihoods were endangered. People's ability to feed their families was endangered in some cases. So there's a real harm to the implications that can come from a misnomer of a disease. H1N1, though, does not come trippingly off the tongue. So we've probably going to have to do better. In Holland, one of my colleagues here is originally from Holland and mentioned to me that they were referring to it as the Mexican flu. I think I'd rather go for swine flu if you've got a choice, but neither of those is really going to convey what people need to know. You know, Twitter is so new and it's evolving so quickly that on the one hand, we're in a situation in the very, very old days when you relied on Pony Express, the challenge was very frankly one of speed and that you just didn't get very much information. So you got not much information and you got it slowly. We're in an era now where you get a huge amount of information and you get inundated with it, but sorting the wheat from the chaff is not something that most people may be trained to do. So that filter is one that I think we're going to have to struggle to equip the sort of general person, the general citizen with. It becomes much more important that they know who to turn to for the final word. So maybe they could say, I will get additional information from my Twitter colleagues. But you need to know whether you're in fact supposed to be looking north or south on this disease. And it's important to have some basic anchors in the little more traditional information sources, like your state and local health department, for example, if it's about a disease outbreak. And then you can follow the finer details maybe from these faster sources. The federal government varies very much from agency to agency how much they've paid attention to the possibilities of the new technologies. CDC has gone through a tough era the last 8 years, a lot of challenges, and some things have gone well, and some things perhaps have not gone so well. One of the things, though, I think that they really have taken on is the community, setting up systems to effectively get information out to a wider variety of audiences than they used to communicate with. So they're actually leading some of us at the state and local level, I think, in experimenting with this. One of the things actually we're watching, our center is involved in some research around emergency communications. We have a federal grant to look at the very practical questions of how do you get information quickly and credibly to people who are vital in an emergency, healthcare providers, vulnerable populations, people who with limited English proficiency or limited health literacy. And we're looking at Twitter and text messaging and so on to see if they may work better than newspapers or standard media for some populations. It's a question. We don't know the answer yet. I haven't seen anything that suggests that the newer technologies added much with the recent H1N1 flu situation. It was pretty clear in a non-disease situation, the attack in Mumbai. I was impressed by the way Twitter was used in that situation to give very current, very specific information that there really was no other way to get. Now, it's fine information. It's small information. So there still has to be another system that puts it into real intelligent, robust information that allows action. And I think maybe that would be the caution, is that Twitter is a byte, the equivalent of a byte, but it's not a story yet. You really need a lot more than that to have a story. And you shouldn't act until you have a story. One of the things that I hope is a lesson that we can give more attention to out of the recent flu, I don't know if it's an outbreak or a scare, but either way, it's important. It highlighted again that the public health agencies, which you don't see most days, are actually behind the scenes constantly trying to protect people. It's like you don't want to see the firefighters every day, but when you have a fire, you want a full, robust fire department to respond. We may not want to see the health departments every day, but if we have a scary outbreak or a contamination of our spinach or a drinking water system failure, we want to know that they're robust enough to respond. This flu situation hit right in the middle of the dismantling of many state and local health departments across the country as a response to the budget shortfalls that are a very real struggle, a very real problem with no easy answers. Many communities made a choice to spare the fire department and the police department of cuts and to disproportionately cut public health. That they may have to find a way to have a more balanced view of what protecting people really involves and see that public health is an essential part of the team. And if they don't have a balanced team, you know, the fire department can't protect them from the flu. So I hope this will allow for a discussion that puts public health in a balanced and appropriate place along with other essential safety services.